Welcome back to my channel. If you're new, my name is Sherry and I'm originally from Canada, but I moved to Singapore for work around 2 years ago now, and today I will be talking about apartment hunting. So I'm gonna be trying to cover everything I can about the basics, about the different types of housing, what hotspot areas there are that people from other countries tend to live in, things to be aware of, tips, and the most important part is really just to show you guys some of the viewings that I went to so you can get an idea of around how much you're paying for what size apartment. Today's video is going to be quite long, so I have left all the timestamps down below. So if you want to just skip to different sections, you are more than welcome to, although I totally think you should just watch the whole video from beginning to end, you know? Let's jump right into it. First things first, let me just cover the absolute basics of renting in Singapore. If you're looking to rent a private property, you need to rent it for at least 3 consecutive months. So you can't do sort of like Airbnb in someone's private home for like 2 months while you try to find a place to live in. That's just not legal here, unfortunately. There are a few different ways that you can get around this if it's your first time coming to Singapore and you want to still leave yourself some buffer room to apartment hunt before you sign like a 1 or 2 year lease. We'll cover that later. Second thing is, how long is it going to take for you to do the apartment hunting and get everything sorted so that you can move in? Personally, for me, I would recommend at least 1 month. A little bit more than 2 months is too excessive in my opinion, because most of the time, if you go and view an apartment that you're not moving in within the next 2 months, they'll be like, okay, we're looking for a move-in date that's earlier than that. So it's kind of a waste of time anyway. But of course, the earlier you start, you can just start looking at what's available in the market. But I feel like the 1 to 1.5 month mark is sort of like the sweet spot, because you can actually properly negotiate and start planning in your move-in date. Any shorter than that, you'll fall into the problem that I did with my current apartment that I moved into, is that it was just so stressful trying to just sign the letter of intent, the tenancy agreement, coordinate all the move out cleaning and moving. Just leave yourself, I would say, 1 to 2 months time frame at least. The third thing to know are, what are the different places you can even rent in Singapore? So the first one are HDB units. HDB stands for the Singapore Housing Development Board. So these are the public subsidized housing, and it's what the majority of the local Singapore population live in. It's a great avenue to go to, especially if you're a student and you're trying to stay within a certain budget. And then the second category are condos. Personally, this is what most of the people that I know who are from foreign countries and are working here tend to live in condos. They're also like apartment buildings. However, they usually have many amenities. You've got usually a pool, sometimes they have tennis courts, barbecue pits are usually quite common, party rooms or like function rooms that you can book out. The third bucket are what I call sort of the more historical slash heritage types of homes. These are shop houses or walk-up apartments. They've got a lot of character. They tend to be slightly larger in size. And the fourth one are serviced apartments. I don't think they're the most economic way of spending your money if you're looking for a place long-term. However, if you just moved to Singapore and you need to just find a short-term accommodation, as I mentioned earlier, you can't rent a private unit for less than 3 months. So serviced apartment is kind of the way to go. Obviously, they're sort of like hotels, so they can be quite pricey, but there are quite a few options in Singapore for you to choose from. If you don't mind living with other people, or you proactively want to because you want to make friends, and also if you are looking for a relatively shorter accommodation, co-living spaces is a great place to look at as well. There are companies like Hamlet or like Cove. I personally know a lot of friends living in those as well. So definitely a very viable option. And then the last bucket are landed properties. So these are basically the houses in Singapore. This is definitely way too expensive for me, and also because I live alone, there's like zero point for me to rent a house. But if you're moving here with your family and you've got kids or got a dog, then this is a great avenue to look at as well. In order for me to find the apartment that I'm living in right now, let me just share with you guys what my personal requirements were. So one, I like living alone, so that was a huge thing. I want the whole space to myself, so co-living was already scratched off for me. The second thing is, I'm quite flexible in terms of the layout of the unit, so it can be a 1-bedroom or 2-bedroom would be great as well, where I can turn one of them into an office slash guest bedroom, or a studio is fine as long as the studio is spacious enough where I don't feel claustrophobic in my own apartment. The third thing would be the price, which is actually the most important part. Ideally, I actually wanted to spend below max 3,300 Singaporean dollars. Obviously, right now it is COVID, so Singapore is like fluctuating between working from home, working in the office. So the one thing I really cared a lot about is, if I needed to work from home, I had space to put a desk and an office chair. And then if I needed to go to work, that my commute would not be longer than max 25 minutes by public transport. I really wanted to have a balcony where I could at least put a table and a chair so I can eat outdoors, al fresco style. And then the last thing is, for me, I know that this is not going to be my forever home, so I actually wanted the place to be furnished and ideally furnished with new furniture. Let's talk a little bit about when you look for your apartment, where can you start searching? There are a few platforms you can go to, but I would say the most common two are Property Guru and 99.co. Personally, I like Property Guru more. I just think the interface is a little more user-friendly and just less cluttered, but you'll see that a lot of the times they actually have the same repeat listing, so either one works. Aside from going on these websites, you can of course get an agent for yourself. I personally have not needed to do that at all. I just like scheduling my own schedules, so I want to just contact the landlord's agent directly. Also, I didn't necessarily want to pay the fees for it, so I was like, let's just keep the costs down low. Once you're on Property Guru and you find an apartment that you like, usually for me, I would just WhatsApp everyone. So definitely get comfortable using WhatsApp. You don't really do it via email here. And when you first WhatsApp the landlord's agent, they ask you for your profile, which includes your nationality, your occupation, what industry you work in, whether you have pets, how many people are living there, what your budget is, and when your move-in date is, and what the term will be, whether you're 1 year, 2 years, or more. From there, you schedule an apartment viewing. In terms of the most common areas that expats tend to live in, one of the most common ones would definitely be Orchard. It's where a lot of the shopping malls are. Personally, I don't like living so close to shopping malls, and I don't really go shopping often anyway, so it's not an ideal place for me. But there are many condos there, and many of the condos there have amazing facilities. Another area relatively close to Orchard is Tanglin. Aside from condos, you'll also find a lot of landed houses as well. It's definitely a family-friendly area, and it's definitely very bougie. One of the most common areas I think I heard of when I first moved here is River Valley / Robertson Quay. It's sort of just this massive area somewhat along the river, and it's where there's a lot of smaller condos as well. Some of the spots in River Valley will be slightly bigger because they're slightly older, but there honestly is such a huge variety. You really have to just go on Property Guru and look at specific condos. Really popular area, La Chambéry. This is an area with tons of cafes. I've filmed a bunch of videos there before as well. That's an area with a lot of walk-ups as well as some condos. The walk-ups, they are heritage buildings, right? So they're slightly older, but some of them have been renovated inside and it looks beautiful. And you can also furnish it to make it, you know, your own space. So there's a lot you can do with it. And then of course, a lot of people choose to live downtown closer to work. So this would be sort of Marina Bay or Tanjung Pagar area. There's tons and tons of high-rise condos there. And they're super lovely. They tend to have a lot of amenities like the tennis courts, and a lot of professionals tend to live there as well because of the close proximity to work. There's also areas like Novena or Newton that is near Orchard. And then of course there's Holland Village. Holland Village has a little street which there's a lot of restaurants and a lot of cozy little bars. And in an area you obviously cannot forget is East Coast. But it's an entire stretch along the coastline where there's areas like Joo Chiat or like the Katong area in general. Tons of local vibes there, and a lot of people with families tend to like living there because there's more space. You've got like lovely parks and park connectorways where you can cycle with the family. Super lovely area as well. So definitely just give the different areas a go, and then you won't know what you like until you actually physically go there. So I would highly recommend everyone, especially if you're signing at least a 1 or 2 year lease, definitely go visit all the different neighborhoods so you can narrow it down. We talked all about the different areas. Let's just go right ahead and look at some of the apartments that I viewed. This apartment is a one bedroom apartment going for $2,800. It is 495 square foot. It is relatively small, but it is a super new condo with super new furnishing. So you'll see that a lot of the new condos actually have very narrow layouts, and it's very narrow and deep, where part of the hallway is the kitchen. You'll see that this is the living room space. It's actually just got space for maybe a dining set, a small one, and then a couch and TV. One of the things I do love about this apartment is that the balcony is of a decent size. You can fit a little table out there, and the view is just super lovely. Just no obstruction in the way, no other building directly in front of it. But I will say this apartment is honestly very small, especially for that price. It's so small that the fridge is kind of awkwardly on the side, right by the entrance to the bedroom. It's just very odd, especially for someone like me who loves cooking. The bedroom itself is a decent size. You still got a lot of light, but the closet space is actually very small, and the biggest concern I have with this apartment is that I don't think I can even work at home from here because I don't see any place where I can properly fit a desk. The bathroom itself is very lovely. Honestly, that's the max size that you really need for one person. I will say though, the thing about Principal Garden that they boast the most is that it has a lot of amenities, and the condo itself is very new, so it's very beautiful. There are so many swimming pools here. I remember the agent told me, I think this might be the condo with the most number of swimming pools. I'm not quite sure why they feel the need to compete on that. There's a tennis court, there's reading rooms, lounge rooms, barbecue pits. This is definitely how a lot of the newer condos look like. Next up, we've got a condo called Riverside 48. So earlier I did mention most condos have barbecue pits and a bunch of amenities. This is actually one of the condos that do not have that. But one of the things that's lovely about this condo is the location. This is right in the hot expat spot of Robertson Quay. So this is a one-bedroom apartment going for $3,000. It's around 700 square foot, and it is a slightly older condo, which is why it has such a big size. You can see that there are massive windows. It's lovely view. The bedroom itself is actually a really great size. The bedroom can fit a desk, and you can also have space to just walk around. You can tell that the washroom and the kitchen is actually quite old. Itself is actually a really lovely size. It's just the issue is that a lot of the appliances are quite old. So if your landlord is really lovely and really nice, maybe they'll be willing to switch it out, and you can talk about this during the negotiation period. But that's kind of the trade-off that you need to have sometimes, is older condos tend to just be bigger and newer condos tend to be smaller unless you're willing to pay the price. Then we've got RV Residences. This is a two-bedroom apartment, 678 square foot, going at a steep price of $3,500. I honestly think that's quite expensive for such a small space. You'll see that I actually look at other 700 square foot apartments that are actually slightly cheaper and feels more open. So you've got a living room and a dining room space. At least you've got a little more counter space going on there. There's no balcony here though, so that is definitely a downfall for me. This is a two bed, two bath, so you've got a guest bathroom and the guest bedroom. The guest bedroom itself is honestly not huge. You can literally fit one bed or like one desk and one chair in there. But if you're turning it into an office, it is a really good size for that. Then you've got the actual master bedroom area, which is also, you really just fit a desk there. And then you've got an ensuite bathroom, which is quite standard. RV Residences is one of the lower rise condos. I don't think it goes above like 10 floors or so. It's got all the amenities. It's got a swimming pool and it's got a gym. The gym is actually quite large for a condo. But I wasn't willing to shell out that much money, even if I negotiated it down by a few hundred bucks. Just didn't give me the right vibe that I was looking for. And then we've got another slightly older condo. This is Valley Park, and it is 860 square foot, which is actually huge, and it's going at $3,500. It's got a very interesting open-esque kitchen concept. The living room is actually massive, and you've got a balcony which overlooks the river, which is really, really lovely in my opinion. I love running along this river, so it's actually a really great location. The main problem I had with this place is that it's very dated, it's very old, everything is quite old, and the landlord wasn't willing to do any appliance changes, even though things were stained all sorts of colors. But I will say, for the size, if you manage to get one of the renovated units in this condo, I would totally go for it. It's definitely a very family-oriented condo. The pool had like a million children running around in there and screaming, crying, kicking, laughing. I think you can tell by my tone of voice that clearly I have no kids, so it's not the area for me. But if you got kids, they'll be able to make friends, which is great. Another condo I look at is called River Place. This is once again in Robertson Quay. Can you tell I really love living along the river? This is $3,100 for an 830 square foot place, which is actually a really good price if you think about it. You've got a kitchen, a lovely open dining room area, and then a great sized living room. What you see about the older condos is that a lot of the times they have their washing and drying machine outside the unit in this little sort of corner area. Then you've got the bedroom here and a bunch of closet space. And then, of course, you've got the bathroom. So this is actually one of the non-renovated units I saw. This condo has a bunch of pools and it's very definitely oriented at families as well. You see a lot of kids and you've also got a gym. But I will say, of course, this is one of the older condos. There's a reoccurring theme. Older condos tend to be slightly bigger. Next up is a building called Espada. This is in River Valley. So it's a one bedroom going for 3,500 bucks, which is definitely pricey, especially considering it's only 670 square foot. So as you can tell, the kitchen is quite tiny and narrow, but the actual living room and bedroom is actually quite nice. It's very airy and spacious and it's a corner unit. So they actually renovated this place to break down all the walls. So it's a very open concept. I love the fact that it's a corner unit and you've got a lot of balcony space and you can just see all of sort of River Valley right in front of you. Not a huge fan of how close the other buildings are because I feel like they can literally look into my apartment, but I do really love the sort of open vibes. So I actually viewed another unit at Espada. This is the exact same layout, but this is a two bed, two bath. So they squeezed it into the same 670 square foot, but the layout is entirely different. As you can tell, this person, the landlord, renovated it completely. The kitchen looks a lot better, but there is still very little space. What they did with the second bedroom, they turned it into a sort of permanent work study office, and that basically means like I can't remove the desk. So if I actually wanted to make this a guest bedroom and put a bed, I would only be able to put a single bed, I think, and even then that is quite tight. The master bedroom, like the other unit, is also in the corner area, so you can still get a really good glimpse of all the city, and the washroom definitely looks a lot better after renovation. But if you guys love this sort of finishing, definitely check out co-living spaces like Hemlet, because a lot of the Hemlet apartments are renovated to this degree and look really nice and modern and cozy. Okay, I've got a different area for you guys. This is Spottiswood Residences. It's in sort of Tanjong Pagar area slash Outram Park, which is very close to the city. So if you work downtown, this is a great condo. This is a one bedroom apartment going for around 3,000 and it's 600 square foot. So even though it's 600, it actually feels a lot more open relative to the Espada one. It's almost kind of giving you like a very studio-esque vibe. Kitchen, once again, it's very standard, kind of just like part of the hallway, not too much kitchen space. So that's one of the downfalls about living in a smaller one bedroom or studio apartment. But the thing I love the most about Spottiswood Residences, hands down, is the balcony. You see that the balcony is actually massive. You can fit an actual outdoor couch set there if you wanted to, or a proper dining set, which is very, very rare for a one bedroom apartment on the newer side. The bedroom itself is great, but the closet is actually a bomb shelter. So I have friends that live in this building and they tell me that because it's a bomb shelter, not a normal closet, they have a lot of humidity and moisture issues. But if you move here, I think you can just put a lot of those moisture balls in the closet and problem solve that way. The bathroom is actually quite new as well. So Spottiswood, honestly, I think is a really lovely place to live in. Ultimately, I didn't go with this one because I just thought it's too close to work, but I do think it's a very lovely place and the amenities are great. The swimming pool is massive and I have so many friends living in this condo, this specific one. All the different towers, I know at least a handful of people. So a lot of working professionals for sure. So I looked at a few apartments that were close to the $4,000 mark. This is 3950 for a 915 square foot place. Two bed, two bath. So it is definitely on the larger side. This is also in the sort of River Valley type area. As you can tell, the kitchen is really much bigger. It's enclosed, which I love because if it's open kitchen, when I cook, it infiltrates my entire living room with scents. The living room is very lovely. They definitely renovated this place because it's newer than a lot of the other apartments in the same condo. I really love that it's a corner unit, so tons of natural light. It is very airy and very bright. First bedroom is actually the master bedroom that I'm gonna show you. So it is a really nice size. You've got the bed, but of course a little bit of space to walk around. But the dresser is definitely of a really great size. And then you've got a lovely bathroom. Second washroom kind of looks tacky with those tiles, but we're looking at the layout, so I'm not gonna comment on that, even though I just did. Second bedroom is decent size as well. You can fit a bed or make it a really lovely office, actually. So I really like that. And then the second closet would be lovely for extra storage room. The condo itself is not the newest, but there is also a really lovely swimming pool. However, I did not end up going with this one, obviously, because even if I negotiated the price down, I think I personally would not have been too comfortable spending that much money. But two is, if I'm gonna pay almost 4K a month for a place, I would much rather it have a balcony. I saved one of my favorites for last. This is a one bedroom apartment at Concourse, which is in the Bugis area. For a one bedroom, it's actually really big because it's 818 square foot, but it is going at a hefty price of 3,700 bucks. But you can see the reason why right here. Look at that view. I feel like I could be the agent for this apartment. That view is a million bucks. You're overlooking Tanjong Rhu. You get the same view in the bedroom and a glimpse of the Ferris wheel, of Gardens by the Bay, the most iconic buildings. Oh my gosh. Yeah, the bedroom is lovely. But the weird thing about this apartment is that they didn't make a door for the closet, which I really just don't understand. And then the bathroom is lovely. There's a window, which gives me hotel vibes. And then the bathroom actually connects back into the kitchen area. And the kitchen area is also very nice. I love that it's actually got a lot of counter space for the fact that it's a one bedroom. Man, I really wish I had chosen this place, but actually it is definitely on the pricey side and I'm very happy with my current apartment. So those are some of the apartments that I viewed. Now let's talk a little bit about rent negotiations and budgeting and just general tips. So when it comes to apartment hunting, my rule of thumb is always negotiate. Like, it doesn't hurt. If you haven't already, read this book. Never Split the Difference is seriously, hands down, one of my favorite books. It's a book written by an FBI hostage negotiator. It's got a ton of concrete examples, and there's a point in this book where he talks about negotiating to buy a car that he really wants, and I literally had that page open and was using this as a literal script for when I was WhatsApping an agent to negotiate for a unit. So this actually works. Aside from the actual negotiation piece, obviously keep in mind how much utilities will cost for you. So things like water, electricity, broadband network, cable, if you like cable. For me personally, my max 3,300 budget ideally was actually including utilities, which is why I was actually going for the 3 to 3.3K max budget. So right now, just for reference, I'm in an apartment that has two air conditioning units. For someone who lives alone and uses the air conditioning unit quite often, I pay around 200 bucks or so a month on utilities. You can also go on Facebook pages. There's a bunch of expat groups where people very kindly share their various averages that they have. So it's a really great resource for you to look at that as well. Then in general, there are just a few things that I think you should be aware of. I was actually moving right before Chinese New Year, and then I looked at the same apartments out of curiosity because I permanently just have the Property Guru app on my phone. I love looking at like properties, but I saw that the same units were going for slightly cheaper after Chinese New Year. I don't know if it's actually a huge difference or if there's even any difference, but that being said, with COVID, what I hear is that if you're moving into a one or two bedroom apartment during this time, it's actually quite in high demand. I do find that things tend to go quite quickly. I think it's because a lot of solo, you know, working professionals are moving into Singapore. But what I did hear is that if you're looking at places that are maybe 3 to 4 bedrooms and above, where you're a family, there's actually quite a lot of options for you because a lot of families moved back to their home countries and have left Singapore, so there are more vacancies. Of course, take it with a grain of salt because by the time you watch this video, things might be different, but maybe something to just keep in mind. When it comes to signing a contract, if you're someone who is on some type of work visa in Singapore, i.e. you're not local, make sure that you look into getting a diplomatic clause added in if you can. It's a clause that basically protects you, where if you, for whatever reason, lose your job, you need to move out of Singapore permanently, or you're no longer with your employer, for whatever legitimate reason you can't stay in Singapore, you don't have to swallow the rest of the payment for all the remaining months. You can actually activate your clause as long as you give them a little bit of an advance notice, which is outlined in the contract. Although I think a lot of times it's usually 2 month notice, and then you don't have to worry about the rest of the pay. You're just off the hook, which is great. So make sure you include that in there in case of any unfortunate events. The one last thing I must say about Singapore and apartment hunting here, my personal experience, is that you really gotta just put in the hours to do some of the viewings. It really does not compare when you get a video versus going in person, because I have a list of things that I personally look out for. Like, you know, I like to know how my neighbors are like. Do the neighbors leave all their shoes and a bunch of crap outside their apartment? Are the neighbors smokers? Because I personally am not. So if I open my balcony and there's just a whiff of cigarette smoke every day, I'd probably feel a little bit like That's my personal preference. And then, you know, very obscure small details that you really just gotta go and visit in person. Give yourself the chance to visit apartments in person so you can really just make sure everything is all nice and sound. So those are my tips when it comes to apartment hunting in Singapore. I hope you guys are able to use these tips to find your dream home. To be honest, there are actually a lot of other things I can talk about with regards to housing, like moving in, moving out, things to be aware of, how to make sure you get your deposit back. That's gonna have to be a topic for another day if you guys are interested, because girl needs to have some water and just take a break from talking. Thanks for watching, you guys. If you have any questions, of course, leave them in the comments below and I'd be more than happy to answer them. And I will talk to you guys next time. Bye!